thank you for coming. So my name is Brendan Bouffler, or most people just call me Bouff. If you come from Australia like I do, then what happens is when you're a child, everybody shortens your name and they keep chopping off one syllable at a time until there is only one syllable left, and that becomes your name for life. So my name is Bouff. I am I'm the head of the research computing group inside Amazon. You all know who Amazon is. We are the online book and decorative pillow company. I love this slide because these folks wrote an article about us, and they referred to us, you know, as the book and pillow seller. And they were, you know, musing on the fact that we had come so far to be able to build a lot of, you know, really interesting stuff, and that the cloud was a particularly interesting thing that had come out of the company. And the thing that amuses me the most is that I think when Jeff Bezos was setting up a company and, you know, turning it into an online book seller and decorative pillows as well, he probably didn't ever imagine that he would have a scientific computing organization inside his company. That would have been a million miles away from what he was thinking. So anyway, so that's the group that I run. I have a long background in building supercomputers. I live in London and manage the team from there. And our job is to think of ways of making the cloud apply to science and research in a very disruptive way. Right, so my first day on the job a few years ago when I joined Amazon, my boss told me that our job is to disrupt things and to move into markets and make sure that everybody was doing things differently to the way that they'd ever done it before. So that's a good instruction to get. So when I was mentioning earlier, I was talking about Mars. You know, my group does a lot of work with NASA, actually. And so when we think about scientific computing, it's important to keep in mind that scientific computing or research computing spans like the whole gamut from HPC all the way through to low performance computing as well. There's a lot of low performance computing out there. But what we do with these guys, I think you all know who this is, right? You probably all remember seeing him land. So when the Mars rover is wandering around on Mars and collecting data all day, there's a very, very short window in the daytime when there is a communication window open between Earth and Mars. It's quite a short window because we don't have 50 satellites orbiting Mars and a great telecommunications network all around that planet. You know, we have like one or two orbiting satellites that are good for communications. And the bandwidth between Earth and Mars is not very good, right? It's radio waves over a really long distance. So for this very, very short window, when the data arrives from Mars, NASA needs to make some really fast decisions about what's going to be the next 24 hours of instructions. What's the tasking for the rover for the next 24 hours? And so what they do is they rapidly spin up a very big cluster in AWS cloud, and they analyze the data that's come back very, very quickly. So instead of it taking, you know, like maybe 10 hours to process the data and for the scientists to review it, they actually process it in under an hour, like way under an hour. In about 15 or 20 minutes, they process the whole lot. And then they have a package of machine learning algorithms that use the data to try and make some recommended possible missions for the next 24 hours. So that the scientists, when they're reviewing all of this stuff, can make some very quick decisions about what to get this guy to do for the next 24 hours. So it's pretty cool. We get to do some fun stuff. And so that's actually happening every day. Every day when that data comes back from Mars, our clusters, our cloud is actually working to help NASA do all of this stuff. So what we're trying to do for, you know, big scale scientific computing is more or less what the electricity companies did for electricity, you know, 100 or so years ago. If you think about this, this is what a energy power generation station looked like, you know, maybe 100 or more years ago. If you walked in there, you'd see, you know, I think it's amusing that you see these guys posing for a photograph and they're wearing suits. They're in a power station and they're wearing suits. If you walked into an electricity power generation plant now, you'd never expect to find anybody wearing a suit, right? They'd be wearing overalls and uniforms and, You know, it's a very industrial kind of thing. But back then, you know, this was a boutique thing. And in fact, if you wanted to use a lot of electricity, you'd have your own power generation plant on your site, right? Which is, again, it's kind of a weird thing that if I want to use electricity, I have to generate my own electricity. That's mad, right? So, so the electricity companies came along and turned electricity into a thing that you get out of the wall, right? When I walked in here, I plugged in my laptop. I did not have to call anybody and ask them to provision 39 watts of electricity for my laptop. I didn't have to call in advance. It wasn't necessary. Unfortunately, I couldn't also call in advance to get the video fixed up, but I did not have to ask for 39 watts of electricity. So I just plug it in and turn it on, and I didn't even think about the cost even. It's trivial. So we want to do the same thing for computing, and particularly for HPC, we want to do the same thing. We want to make it trivial so that people can do it all the time. But this is what HPC has been looking like for many years. Again, it's the same thing, you know, a big industrial setting and people having their photographs taken in front of these big computers. They're very proud of having built these supercomputers. Right, and so we really want to change this. We want to change this around. So fortunately, a few years ago, this guy came along and shook up the entire operating system market. And it's changed a lot of things, because what it meant was that we could build Unix machines really cheaply, or Unix-like machines. And we could also, you know, combining that with some of the techniques that came out of the experiments at various different labs in the US. My friend Thomas Sterling pioneered a thing called a Beowulf cluster. And the idea was that you strap a lot of little machines running Linux together and you make it into one big powerful machine. And this was really the birth of parallel computing. He figured that if we could use commodity parts to build a lot of small parts into a single big thing and make it look like one coherent thing, we could really build a supercomputer. So Linux was really pivotal to that. So anyway, what it meant was that this revolution came along and it disrupted this, and it sort of turned it into this for a while. And this guy is a lot less attractive than, you know, the previous people, and he's, you know, this is not exactly a picture you want to hang on your wall, right? So this is sort of the interim while we're changing stuff, but it's sort of indicative of the kind of change that we wanted to bring about, and I think we're not doing too bad. So before I get to the, I'll get in a minute, we'll get to the place where we got to with all of this, but I'll show you a few other things. So one of the other things that we are now trying to do to cause innovation and to, you know, to really drive innovation and also to disrupt the way that people are doing computing is we came up with a thing called Lambda. Does anybody in here know what Lambda is? Cool. Okay, so we've got a couple of Lambda users in here. So this is really neat. So one of my guys today texted me from Australia this morning. He's one of the guys on my team out there. He texted me to let me know that we just got a couple of blogs posted by some customers. And this is a customer who'd used, that actually used Lambda to do some CRISPR genetic engineering codes. So this new CRISPR technique, if you follow genetics at all, this new CRISPR technique is a really, really interesting way of actually being able to design whole genomes. And you can essentially assemble an entire genome from parts, right? So it's a really, really innovative technique, but it requires a lot of computing in order to plan it and to work out what you're going to do and how to construct these molecules and get it done right. And so it's a massive amount of computing. Usually you'd throw it at an HPC cluster. That'd be a normal workload for an HPC cluster. But most interesting was that these guys decided that what they would do would be to split this job up into a billion or two jobs. So literally billions of jobs, and throw it at Lambda and see what Lambda could do with it. So I'm happy to say that what's really cool about it was this quote down here, that a typical scan job takes less than a minute. And thanks, because Lambda just keeps increasing the amount of compute on demand based on the amount of load that it's receiving, they can actually keep the compute time constant because Lambda just keeps consuming all of the jobs that come along and it dynamically expands in the back end. So the really neat thing is that no matter how busy this thing gets, it seems to just keep running at the same speed all the time. And that's a common kind of workload that we really like trying to help customers with, right? So this is actually really cool. And the other text message that I got was that this is, you know, they're doing a lot of genetic engineering with these techniques, and it's costing the organization, this scientific organization called CSIRO, it's costing them $15.70 per month. Because they're, you know, it's all consuming in Lambda. So this is really cool. It's a pretty interesting thing. We also do a lot of work with notebooks. Has anybody played with Jupyter or IPython notebooks? Cool. So this is a really interesting technique for tracking your scientific works, tracking your effort and so forth. But it's also an interesting technique to be able to scale. Because if you've got Jupyter running on your notebook, on your laptop, like you've got a Jupyter notebook running on your laptop, I should say, and what you're doing is something that's working fine on one or two or three or four cores on your laptop, but you suddenly need to go to a chunkier amount of compute because your problem size has got bigger, well, you can flip from a laptop straight over to a server pretty quickly, right? So you can just punch up a Jupyter notebook instance in the cloud within a few minutes and start computing in the cloud, and you can have virtually any size kind of compute node in the cloud. So you could put this on a 36 core machine in the cloud that would cost you like 75 cents an hour, or you could put this on an X1 which has got 2 terabytes of RAM, 128 cores. You could go crazy. You could back it onto a cluster. You could also back it onto P2 instance. So the P2 instance is our new K80 GPU. Instance. And so a lot of this is, you know, this screenshot here was actually taken from a machine learning use case where one of my folks was playing with the new K80 GPU instances just before they came out, and he was experimenting to see what kind of deep learning codes that he could run on those. But the really neat thing is that, you know, it's basically, you know, with these kinds of techniques you can just scale to whatever level that you need. So we think that's a pretty good use case as well. So a whole lot of this is actually backed by our global infrastructure. Well, of course, all of it's backed by the global infrastructure, but the key thing about having the global infrastructure is we've got an awful lot of regions in the world, and that leads us to having an awful lot of capacity. I'll show you what the implications are of that in a minute because it's kind of fun, but the reason we think the cloud is interesting to science is because of this global infrastructure. So if you've got, you know, as data sets get bigger and bigger, right, and let's say you're playing with a petabyte of data because you're doing some genomics work, a petabyte of data is really hard to move around. You know, when I was studying astronomy and working in astronomy as a physicist, it was a suitcase full of hard drives. That's how we move data around, or suitcase full of tapes, actually. That's how we move data around. It's a terrible thing to do. The reason we had to do that is because, you know, you had to move the data to the compute. You know, the computers were big and monstrous and you had to move the data to the compute, right? Well, in the cloud, we actually flip that on its head and we say that you should actually move the compute to the data. You should actually move your virtual machines close to where the data is, do the compute there and take the results somewhere else. And we do that because it's kind of crazy to actually spend a whole lot of time moving data around and copying it. Because when you move data around on a suitcase full of hard drives, you know, big box full of hard drives in the back of a car or big box full of hard drives shipped by FedEx around the world, all you're really doing is wasting a lot of money and you're making copies of data. And you're spending money on copies of data, which doesn't actually make sense because that doesn't process the data. It just generates another copy of the data. Right, you'd be better off spending your bucks on computing the data. Right, so this infrastructure is really important to that because then you can stand up a data set in Frankfurt, in our Frankfurt region, and you can share it with a collaborator around the world by sending them a link, and it's literally that easy. Right, so actually being able to iterate your algorithms or iterate your workloads is much faster is enabled by doing that. I don't know if you know much about the way that our regional structure works, but the interesting thing about the region structure is that a region for us is a geographical area, right? So when we say that we have a region in Frankfurt, what that means is we have a cluster of data centers in Frankfurt. When you push a block of data into the Frankfurt region, like you push something into S3 there, we have all of the facilities that we need to keep that redundant and safe and backed up and all that stuff. All of those facilities exist in Frankfurt. So we don't, you know, if you put a block of data into Frankfurt, it doesn't move. Right? We don't need to copy it to Singapore or London or Dublin in order to make sure that, you know, it's sort of safe in case of a disaster or a mistake. We don't do that. So it actually means that, you know, data sovereignty is really, really strongly underpinned by the structure of this cloud. So inside those cloud regions is a number of availability zones, as we call them. So if you want to run a workload that needs high availability, you can plan it to run across two or three availability zones. And that means that, you know, if something happens in one availability zone, like a flood, that takes out an availability zone of ours, then you have other availability zones that are still running your workload. Right, and so you can plan for really highly available things. This is not something that a lot of science folks do, because usually most science folks, when they say, why would I want to spend money on two cores when only one of them is running? That's crazy. So it's not a common case in science to do that. But there are still some cases where it needs to be done, particularly when it comes to data itself. If you want to make sure that your data is safe and can withstand an earthquake or a flood or an electricity problem, then this is the way to do it. So that's how we build things like S3 that have got 11 nines of durability and really, really high uptime. So we talked about the collaboration part. This is interesting. This is an interesting map of the world showing where all the scientific collaborations are around the world. This is based on peer-reviewed scientific literature. So every time one of you guys writes a scientific paper and you're listed as an author on the paper, with a lot of co-authors from other institutions around the country or around the world, then we can draw on a map like this, we can draw a line between your institutions or between your cities, and we start to get a bit of a visibility into where all of the scientists live around the world and who's talking to whom and who's working with whom. And it's you can draw a lot of conclusions from this map. One of the conclusions is that almost nobody ever talks to Australia, and that's why I'm living here. You can also see clusters of collaborations going on, say, for instance, in India and China, Japan. You can see that American scientists work with each other a lot. But the really interesting thing from this map is that everybody works with European scientists. If you want to be a scientist anywhere in the world and earn your stripes and generally have people respect you, you need to have a European collaborator. So you guys are at the... You're at ground zero. You're at the epicenter of the worldwide scientific community. It's pretty cool. You're very lucky. Anyway, so like I said before, it makes it easy to... The cloud makes it a bit easier for that collaboration. We think that greases the wheels of the collaboration. The other thing that we think is really important for this space are big data sets, giant data sets. This is a really important space. So when I said before that, you know, it's crazy having multiple copies of a bit of data running around, when we talk about very popular data sets, like this one here, the 1,000 genomes data set, this is a very common reference data set for genomics people to use in their analysis, right? And, you know, 1,000 genomes data set is a little bit over a petabyte in size. So a petabyte's a lot of data, right? It costs a lot of money to buy a petabyte of storage, more than most of your postgrad research budgets, I suspect. Way more, right? So a petabyte of storage is a ton of stuff to have to actually pay for the storage of. So making multiple copies of that is just crazy when everybody in the world wants to use this one data set for their analysis. So we have a program called our public data set program where we actually look for the world's most popular data sets that are really, really useful to a lot of scientists, and then we just put a copy of them into the cloud and we pay for that. We pick up the bill. And then what it means is that if you want to go and analyze the 1,000 genomes data set, you can. And the only thing it costs you is the compute. Right? And then in fact we'll even show you how to use things like the spot market to get the compute really, really cheap. Right, and that's an incredibly important technique. So what it means is that these big data sets, lots and lots of these big data sets, are actually out there in the cloud already. Some of the most recent really cool ones that I've been having a lot of fun with has been the Sentinel-2 data set and the Landsat data set. So Landsat and Sentinel-2 are satellites that are orbiting the Earth, and they're like space telescopes, right? But instead of the telescope pointing up into space, they point the telescope back down at the Earth, and they're essentially taking pictures of the Earth, of the ground. And what's neat about that is you can tell a lot of stuff. You can see trees. These things are a multi-spectrum or multi-chromatic. So I think I might even have some slides later to talk about it. There's at least eight different layers, eight different frequencies or wavelengths that the images are being taken in. And some of the images, you know, some of them are, say, infrared, and in the infrared you'll be able to see vegetation on the ground. In the near infrared, you'll be able to actually see cities. Cities and industrial areas stand out on those things. So you can actually run some pretty straightforward algorithms over these images and actually start to determine what's the land use across Germany. How much of Germany is dedicated to concrete? How much of Germany is dedicated to trees? How big are those forests? How much do they expand and contract over the course of the year? What's the long-term decline or the long-term increase in the number of forests? These are all really important things. And this is all really important knowledge if you're studying climate change and trying to work out what the future looks like from a climatic point of view. So these satellites are really, really cool, and they're generating a lot of data. They actually generate petabytes of data. And most of what we found was that when we were talking to people who were working in this field, they wanted to use Landsat data, but they couldn't afford $500,000 to go and buy themselves a petabyte of storage. Because all you really needed was $500,000 and you had to know somebody at NASA to get a feed of the data. That's kind of difficult. So we put a copy of this data into the cloud, and now, you know, for $5 you can actually go and analyze all of this data. You know, for a few bucks you can get access to the data in a few seconds. we think that's pretty impactful. So Sentinel-2 is a satellite that's been put up by the European Space Agency. And it's very similar in its mission to what Landsat does, only it's actually better resolution. It's higher resolution imagery with another layer or two of different wavelengths of images that are being taken. So it's even better. It's about 10 times better in terms of resolution or data weight. So this is a really cool project. These are really cool projects. You can do a lot of stuff with these things. Anyway, so the public data sets are really important to us. Have a look in the catalog. I'd be surprised if there's not a data set in there that interests you from a scientific or a research point of view. There's a lot of other data sets. The one I'm just trying to think of, we call it the it's the Common Crawl Corpus. So if you want to write a search engine, it's essentially the data that you find if you were to write a robot crawler that trawled the internet all day, every day. And so this data set is actually growing continuously. And it's a giant data set of the world's web pages, of what you'll find out there on the internet. So if you want to write algorithms that actually study what's on the internet or derive image, information products from that, it's a data set that's already there. You don't have to write that infrastructure. So this actually goes to this thing that we always try and do. We're always looking for places where we can take away some of what we call the undifferentiated heavy lifting. Right? The stuff that people have to do every day that's just the same thing day in, day out. Repetitive, boring stuff that you don't want to do. Like installing an operating system on a computer, building a cluster. These are all things that we think you shouldn't have to do every day. You should be able to press a button and automate that stuff. And so we automate as much of that as we possibly can. So to get to the HPC bit, you know, we did this a few years ago. I think this was, I can't remember what year this was. I think it was about 2013. So, what's that? 4 years ago. So we put this up in 2013. We put an entry into the top 500. So the top 500 is this international list of all of the world's supercomputers, all of the world's biggest ones. And so we're kind of cheeky. We did this to be cheeky. It cost around about $100 an hour for us to run this thing. It took us, a few minutes to turn it on and orchestrate it. And then we ran the LINPACK benchmark on it. And we got a pretty good, we got a great result. You know, for 26,000 cores, we managed to get ourselves at number 76 on the top 500. So we're pretty happy with that. And so that stuck around for a while. I believe that we're not allowed to put any more entries into the top 500 because they were a bit upset that when we did it, we ran the workload, we proved that we could do it, and then we turned it off and we, you know, those machines went back to, I don't know, selling costume jewelry and decorative pillows probably. And, you know, so they're a little bit upset that we did this because this kind of made a little bit of a, maybe a bit of a mockery of the whole idea of the top 500. Because what it meant was that you don't need to go and, you know, to get into the top 500 before, you needed millions of dollars. You needed PhDs everywhere. You needed a lot of work and a lot of effort to build a room full of computers and turn it into a cluster. But now we can do it at the push of a button, right? So, and that's what we think you should be able to do. So coming forward a few years, we now have, we have a partner of ours in the UK. They're a little company called Alsys Flight. Alsys is actually the Latin word for moose, if you really care. I happen to think it's really cool. Anyway, but there's their logo. It looks like moose antlers. These guys actually, you know, they're experts at building HPC clusters, and they've been doing it for a long time. Right, and in fact, you know, we all knew each other from past jobs in different careers. But what they have is something really, really special. What they've done is they've put their software stack into the AWS Marketplace. So the Marketplace in the cloud is sort of like it's an app store for the cloud, right? So where you might go and buy some apps for your phone. Out of the app store, this is the same kind of thing where you can buy apps for the cloud to run in the cloud, and you're buying them online. It's only the difference is, you know, I guess Apple sells you the phone, and then you buy the phone first, you buy the hardware first, and then you go and get the apps. We sell you the hardware with it as well, as it were, in the sense that it's all in the cloud. So they put their software stack into the marketplace. They've managed to, what they've done is they've really encaptured into that marketplace offering all of the complex stuff that's required for building an HPC cluster. Right, so a head node, a file server, complex network topology, a whole pile of software stack on each of the compute nodes. Right, and they've bottled it all up and stuck it in the marketplace so that you can go and hit a button and have an entire cluster in a few minutes. Then the other thing that they did, and this is what I think was even better, is they put all of the scientific applications you might ever want to use on there. So if it's an open source scientific application, it's likely to be in this catalog. The catalog, well, when I made this slide when their first version came out, it was 750 apps in there. Everything from, you know, computational chemistry, quantum cosmology, bioinformatics, electronics engineering, circuit simulation, lots and lots of languages, everything from, you know, Python and C and so forth. But the list is actually now 850, they told me the other day, so it's an even larger list now. But what it means is instead of actually having to go out and build a cluster and then install the software and then install the applications, you actually just turn on a cluster in a few minutes. It takes about 3 or 4 minutes to turn this on. And even better, it actually uses the spot market too. So again, we'll talk about that in a minute because it's interesting. The really cool thing about this is you've basically got yourself a personal HPC cluster, a personal supercomputer. If I gave you I've got a few here. Where are they? I'll have to get some out later. I've got some $50 vouchers, right? These are $50... vouchers for, you know, for getting some credits so you can play around in the cloud. For $50 at 1 cent per core hour, which is a, you know, fairly typical rate in the spot market for buying CPU cores, you can have a 5,000 core cluster for an hour. Well, 5,000 core clusters gets you onto the top 500. So I could give you a voucher today that would get you under, you know, give you a machine that's one of the world's 500 most powerful supercomputers. Right, you can turn it on in a couple of minutes, do some chemistry, split the atom, simulate a whole pile of stuff. You could do some computational fluid dynamics, simulate the airflow around the wing of an aircraft or something like that. And when you're done, you just turn it off and it goes away. And that's pretty cool, right? This is like you know, going down to the National Supercomputer Center and saying, I just want to copy your supercomputer and own it for an hour. And when I'm done with it, I'm going to give it back to you and turn it off. That's really what it is, but you're doing it in a completely retail way. It's pretty cool. So what they've done is really neat stuff. When you've got a personal supercomputer, you can do all sorts of other stuff with it. You can get access to the console. If you went down to your local supercomputer center and said, hey, I want to get access to the graphics console, they'd laugh at you and chase you out of the room with a stick. In this kind of environment, you've got your own personal supercomputer. So you can just flip it open and turn on the graphics console. If there's a package in there that's not installed that you really want, you can install it. Good luck with your national supercomputing facility asking them to do that for you. They just won't do it, right? They're building a very big machine and catering for hundreds or thousands of different users. That's a big operation. But they're spending too much of their time worrying about how to administer the plumbing and the electricity and the air cooling in the machine room and replacing broken hard drives and cables, because these are very, very large machines. I've spent a lot of time in these kinds of environments. They're pretty tough to manage. All of that sort of management gets done often by robots in our data centers. It's heavily automated. But you don't have to worry about it. All you have to worry about is actually spinning up a cluster and doing your code. So we think that's pretty neat. You can share your console. This gets back to that collaboration thing again. I've got a customer in the US who does this all the time with their colleague, with their peer that they're doing research with in the UK. And they just regularly spin up a cluster. This is a genomics application for doing variant analysis, genomics variant analysis. Often what happens is you move a few things around in this console and it kicks off some large HPC jobs in the background to crunch an awful lot of data. These two folks can actually sit together sharing the same desktop. And so visually, while they're over the phone or talking by Skype, they can compare notes and discuss the science, right? And this used to be that they could only ever do this when one of them flew to the other one's location, right? So now they can share a desktop with a personal supercomputer sitting underneath it and progress their work really, really fast. So this changes things, because all it does is it maps the computer onto the workflow of the humans, right? And we're getting computers to think like humans do, that's really the way it should be. So we've got some file systems in there. So if you've got workloads that are going to do big parallel I/O, because you need to be doing gigabytes per second of streaming I/O, there's actually what you need at that point is a clustered file system, and that's often the case inside a typical HPC facility. They'll have a clustered file system for their shared file system. These things are usually pretty big and expensive. One of them is the most well-known one outside Germany is going to be Intel's Lustre, but actually by far and away, and I shouldn't say this, the superior one is actually the one that comes from the Fraunhofer Institute BGFS. It's really cool. It's for various different workloads, it actually runs much, much faster than Lustre. So both of these folks have actually put their offerings into the marketplace. So you can go into the marketplace and spin up a cluster. You can go into the marketplace and spin up a clustered file system as well. Connect the two together, and then get a bunch of work done. And again, you're getting access to all the facilities that not many other people would be able to get access to. And you're getting it for a few bucks an hour, and you turn it all off, and it goes away. Right. So this is clusters and computers now are ephemeral. So. It's interesting to. I need to get you to the spot market, and I want to explain why it's important to you. So, when you buy a computer, you buy a bunch of cores and you hold onto it for a particular period of time. If you buy a cluster, it's no different, right? That's just the way that it works. And your cost is going to be related to the area under that curve. That's how much it's going to cost you: $1 million or €1 million to buy a cluster. You spend your €1 million and you get a cluster. That's how it works, right? The only problem is you may not actually use it all the time. And so really it sort of looks like that, right? The problem is that your cost is still equal to the area in that box, right, when your usage is actually way less than that. So what we do, right, and this is really is what underpins the cloud model, is we, when you're not using it, we go and sell that stuff to somebody else, right? Everybody's coming in and using different portions of compute at different times. And you can think of a region in AWS as being a giant cluster in a way, in this sense. It's a whole lot of cores. And so all of these cores, all of these usages come and go. What happens when you get to a really massive number of users? And what we like is we really like uncorrelated users. We like users that have got nothing really to do with each other. Right? They're doing their own thing. The best example, the best way I can put it is this. If we just sold our cloud services to a payroll company, then what would happen is that on the 28th day of every month, there'd be a massive spike in demand, and the rest of the month it'd be empty. Right? So the shape of this curve would just be flat down here until spike. Right? And that'd be crazy. And I've seen some folks do this. I've seen some oil and gas company clusters that are like this, where they're very, very spiky, peaky kinds of usage. And they're only really using the thing 10% of the time. Right? It's just that with that 10% of the time when they want to use it, they need a really big one. Right? So they have to buy the biggest thing and accept that most of the time it's not being used. Well, that's crazy. So what we do is we look for uncorrelated workloads, people who are just doing their own thing unrelated to anybody else. What it means is that any one of these, once you've got a big enough pile of these uncorrelated workloads, and we've literally got millions of customers now, you know, we've got more than a million customers using the cloud, it means that all of these things just disappear into each other. Any one of them can spike and do 5 or 10 times their normal workload. They can spike up to 5 or 10 times their normal usage of cores or resources, and it's just going to be a drop in the ocean. It's not going to impact anybody else. And so that's actually a particularly cool part, because it means that you can go into the cloud and you can spin up any size thing that you want, and you're not really paying, you're only paying for the bit you use. The other bit that's important here is this spare bit up at the top. We always like to have some spare capacity, you know, the stuff that's not being used. And we've got to have some spare capacity in order to make sure that we can always say yes to a customer when they turn something on, right? It sucks if you go to the cloud and you say, well, I want a, you know, C4 8X large, I want a 36 core instance, and you get the answer that says, sorry, not today, we're full, right? We never want to say that. That's a terrible thing to do, and that really undermines customers' confidence, right? So we always keep some spare capacity, but it's kind of awful, because that spare capacity, if it's not getting used, is just costing money, and everybody will have to pay a sort of a share of that excess thing, right? Unless we're going to lose money on the whole thing, the cost of that excess capacity has to be factored into everybody else's cost just a little bit, right? So what we do instead is we actually auction it off. And this is why I think this is a really interesting thing for scientists, right? This gap up here, we go and auction it in a crazy sort of a slightly weird auction style, and we call it the spot market. And what you do is you go into the spot market and you bid on some resources. And let's say the resources are usually, I don't know, 25 cents an hour for the instance that you're looking for. You can bid 5 cents. You can just say, I feel like offering Amazon 5 cents for that instance for the next hour. And what we do is we stack all of the bids in, you know, highest to lowest. That makes sense, right? Making sense so far. And then we start at the top of the list and we just start allocating all of our spare capacity to those people until we run out. And when we run out, the last person in, the price that they bid is actually the price that everybody pays. Right, which means that they are the last person in. They might have bid 2 cents. You bid 5 cents. You're definitely going to get a first pick before they do. But they bid 2 cents, and they were the last ones in, and they set the price for everybody else. Now, what it means is that the thing about the spot market is you're not guaranteed of having the resource. We'll only take your money if you get one whole hour of usage. We'll only take that, you know, 5 cents an hour from you when you actually have used it for a whole hour. But if somebody comes along wanting to pay full price for an instance, we have to find an instance to give them, right? That's why it was spare capacity to begin with. So we have to find a spare, we have to find an instance. And so what we do is we start at the bottom of the list and we work up. And so the people who are the cheapest bidders go first. They get chosen first to lose their resource so we can give it to a full price paying customer, right? So what it means is there's no absolute guarantee that you're going to have your resources. But what it does mean is that when there are excess resources, you can get them really cheaply and you can get a lot of compute done, right? So let me, I'll show you an example of somebody using it. So this is a bunch of folks from Fermilab in Chicago. They're one of the key sites involved in the CMS experiment at the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, right? So they're one of the key sites. They process a lot of data coming from CERN, from the Large Hadron Collider. They did this workload over a weekend. They peaked out at 58,000 cores. So 58,000 cores, that'd be probably a 3 or 4 petaflop national supercomputer. That's probably most of the national supercomputers in Germany added together. Most of the big supercomputers in Germany combined would probably run at about 3 or 4 petaflops right now. So it's a huge amount of compute. And they used this is all of the spare capacity they used in one of our regions in the US over the course of a weekend. And you can see that the load went up and down. And so what they did is they organized their software so that it could cope with an instance dying. You know, they're using thousands of cores in parallel. But what they did is they wrote their software to be resilient and to be able to deal with the fact that a core might or an instance might just disappear, right, and might get taken offline. And it's actually not too hard to do that. Right, and so they've gone crazy and done it at a huge scale. You can do it at a much smaller scale, and we actually give you data that can help you figure out whether or not what the probability of losing your resources are. Right, so we give you programmatic data like this. There's an API interface to this as well, so you can get it electronically. But this is just a website. This is a website. I took this screenshot a few months ago. This is Irish region in Dublin. I said that I was looking for 8 core instances and that my bid price would be simulate what would happen with a bid price of 50% of the normal price and tell me what the results would be. And what it said was that for all of these instances over here, my probability of getting kicked out of the market at any one time, either in a week or over the course of a month, was low. So that means we've got a lot of spare capacity that you can gobble up. And you'll be able to run things for days or weeks without being very likely to get kicked out, right? And when you do, the average savings at that point, you know, when I did the screenshot, the average price that people were paying is sort of 80 or 90% off the sticker price. So if the resource was worth, you know, $1 an hour, for example, most people were only paying 9 cents per hour for it. So you can tell that if you can work up your jobs to be a little resilient, or if they're going to run for a few hours instead of a few weeks, then you can actually take advantage of this hugely, and you get cheap compute, right? For PhD students, that's pretty popular. Yeah, it's a good. Yeah, there is. There absolutely is. So, if you go back to that last picture, right? There's definitely a difference over the course of this weekend, right? This is a 48-hour. I'm pretty sure this is the 48-hour snapshot. So, 0-12, 0-12. Yeah, I'm pretty sure this is a 48-hour snapshot, right? And so you can see a swing between day and night. Usually the swings, like this is a weekend. Right, so weekends are a bit special. Weekends tend to be pretty quiet, except for maybe Saturday nights when they get really busy. And I think this is probably Netflix. This is probably people watching Netflix, right? That's not a bad guess. I think it's probably true, right? But there is a big swing between day and the night. But if you want to, you could run your jobs in the Sydney region or Tokyo. So Sydney right now is about, I think it's, what is it, they're 11 hours ahead of us? 10 hours ahead of Germany is Sydney. So it's nighttime there. It's going to be very quiet in the Sydney region. You could push your jobs over there and run your jobs in Sydney because it's going to be really cheap for the spot market. And when the spot market gets cheap here, you move your jobs to Germany. And that's pretty easy to do, right? It depends on how big your data is that you're trying to process. If your data is big, you don't want to move that around the planet too much, right? That's going to get time consuming. But depending on your job, yeah, you can exploit that. But it is there are big swings between day and night. That's absolutely true. That's why we have the spot market, right? We have the spot market because there are big swings between day and night. And of a night time when all this CPU is left over and not being used, we don't want it to go to waste, right? And we don't want it to cost us too much either. So it's better if we can get some money for it by selling it on the spot market and sell it to the people who are able to write apps that are able to exploit that. So there's a lot of science gets done with this thing. So I know I've got a couple of slides on this coming up. Let me skip a couple of slides in the order of, you know, in the interest of time. This is really where you want to get to with these kinds of workloads. You want to be able to say, okay, instead of you know, I can run a job on 100 cores for 1 hour, or on one core for 100 hours. Both of those things are gonna, in most cases, get me the same thing. And also they're going to cost me the same thing in the cloud, right? Basically what you're paying for in the cloud is core hours, right? Cores times hours, because we have a pricing around that. One of these gives you an answer in an hour, the other one takes a week. So this is a one question IQ test. Which one of those is better, right? Well, of course you want the one in an hour if you can get it, right? So this is one of the things you can do when you can dive into a big market like that. And if you can dive into a spot market in the middle of the night in a very cheap region and multiply your workload quite a lot, scale it up to an awful large number of cores, more than you normally would, you might get your job run really, really fast. And in fact, a lot of people do exactly that. They run their jobs really, really fast before the price of the spot market goes back up. You know, as the sun starts to rise and people start to get on their computers and their phones and check their email and you know, the cloud gets busy. So they're able to use those gaps. It's a really important thing. For scientist types, what it really means is that you can scale up your science. If you save money that way, or you save resources that way, and you can shift your workloads around, you can do a lot of things. You've got options, right? You can do more science, you know, bigger data sets, bigger problems. You can do them faster. So just say, screw it, I'm just going to do this in 1/3 the time. Or I'm going to use 10 times as many cores and get it done in 1/10 the time. You could buy chocolate. That's a good thing to do with money that you save. Chocolate is good. You could also hire more scientists or more PhD students, right? Those are always good things too. So that helps science go forward. So in fact, one of the PhD students that I work with in Australia at an astronomy institute, they actually did this. They had a task which was they had to process a bunch of data in a 12-hour window in order to meet commitments to their collaborators in different parts of the world. So they figured when they looked at the amount of what the data volume was, and how they're going to meet that commitment, they figured out they needed around about a $2 million HPC cluster. It was around about 100 some nodes with a lot of memory, et cetera, et cetera. They didn't have $2 million, so the research project was just going to go nowhere. But one of their PhD students actually figured out how to do this whole thing in the spot market. They've now got it running for around about $1,200 or $1,300 a month. And you know, that's like that's taken lots of zeros off the end. They're really happy with it. They've got a scientific discovery out of it. So they actually managed to detect neutral hydrogen in a galaxy at twice the previous record. So they were pretty happy with getting a result like that, right? So all of these things are possible. So all of this we do by bolting these sorts of things together. This is a bit of an eye chart showing you all of the services that we run in AWS. But you know, really, building clusters is really just a matter of selecting a bunch of services and connecting them together, right? And that's what the ALSIS stuff that runs in the marketplace does. We have a bunch of specialist instance types, so we have a bunch of specialist hardware that backs these things. So when you build an HPC cluster, you can actually pick out the right nodes. So if you've got a GPU workload, if you've got a workload that's really amenable to GPUs, you can have some GPU instances. If it turns out that you need a lot of memory per core, you can pick an instance type with a lot of memory per core, so you can start to customize your HPC cluster. So we do a lot of work with Intel to build nodes using CPUs that they build specially for us. This is a CPU that, you know, you won't find out on the street. Most of the HPC preferred CPUs of the common era at the moment are around about 2.4 gigahertz CPUs. Well, we can, you know, Intel are willing to let us take their CPUs and essentially overclock them, right? Drive them up to 2.9 gigahertz. We get about 15 to 20% more performance out of that. It means they're running really hot, but we can run them inside a data center where we own the data center. We know what the thermal controls are in the data center, so we can do some cool things. So this is an example of us doing that. The P2s, I think I mentioned these earlier. These are the instance types that have got an awful lot of GPUs in them. In fact, they have 16 GPUs in them. Right, the big monster instance has got 16 GPUs in it. So if you've got deep learning or machine learning code that you want to run, or you've got there's a lot of computational chemistry algorithms that actually are really run really well on GPUs. Vector code tends to work very nicely on GPUs. You can play with these things. The good thing here is that if it turns out when you go to try your code on GPU, and if it turns out that your code doesn't work very well on a GPU, you can just turn it off and you stop paying, and you're no longer worried. You're not stuck with a bunch of GPUs that you bought, right? This is a really important thing. As you go through your scientific careers, you'll realize that the cost of failure is actually going to be a driving factor in how you make decisions when you're doing your research or doing your experiments. If making a mistake or making a decision that turns out not to work costs you too much money or too much time, that's actually really going to slow down your scientific progress, right? So one of the things that we always aim for is we are always aiming at reducing the cost of failure. That's absolutely job number one for the cloud in terms of the application spaces that we work in, right, is to make sure that in terms of how we measure our relevance is whether or not we're making failure cheaper. It should be cheap to make a mistake, and you should be able to make it quickly. If you're going to make a mistake, if the thought experiment that you've got to analyze, to see what the performance of a particular algorithm on a particular set of data is and how efficient it is or how fast it is or whatever. If that's your workload and if that experiment is not going to work, it's better that you get there quickly and cheaply. Make that mistake 10 times cheaper than any other way, and make it happen 10 times faster, and I think you probably make things happen 100 times better in science, right? You'll iterate much, much faster. So I'll skip these last couple of things. There's a lot of stuff we can play with. I'll be hanging around the rest of the afternoon. I've got another talk. We've got another talk in a couple of minutes. We're going to be talking about cities and stuff, smart cities, in fact. I'll be hanging around for another few hours. Once I get done with my next talk, I'll be hanging around downstairs, and we can flip the laptop open, and I can show you some real stuff, given our video problems that we had earlier trying to get it up and running. So anyway, thank you. Thanks for coming, and really interested in hearing your questions later on as well.